Do you know this feeling when you see a technical tweet by some cool hackers you look up to, but you don't understand what they are saying, and then you are also too scared to ask what it means? Well, I know how you feel. I've been there. But that's why I'm here for you now. I want to explain to you in as much detail as I can what this tweet by Mathias Carlson is about. Especially what is up with this name here. That's a really cool trick if you don't know. So welcome to Tweets Explained, or maybe Explainer, I don't know. In this format, I explain to you tweets by hackers. So before we can understand this tweet, we obviously should go to the original, which was quoted here, and that one is by Justin Gardner. He's also a very experienced bug hunter who is also the co-host of an awesome bug bounty podcast called Critical Thinking. They are talking a lot about AppSec and web security related topics, so if you are looking for a more technical podcast, go check it out. But now back to his tweet. Apparently yesterday he exploited a tricky XSS and there was an injection into the JS context and he couldn't use any parentheses, backticks or single quotes. And his solution made use of the fact that any function in JavaScript can take any numbers of parameters. The function looked like this, x with two parameters, and apparently through his injection this is how he triggered XSS. Alright. When trying to understand XSS payloads, especially a little bit more complex payloads, it can make sense to set up a quick XSS testbed where you can play around with it. And PHP is actually a super useful tool for that. So let's create a quick PHP file for testing. We don't necessarily need HTML code here, but I just use some basic boilerplate. And I create a form with a text input where we can submit the XSS payload. The important part is of course the JavaScript tag where we can define our test function x with the two parameters. And I guess let's just call console.log to print the parameters passed into the function. Now we need to call this function and we can do x, string a, string b for testing. We haven't added any PHP code just yet, but let's quickly test it. If you have PHP locally installed, you can now simply execute php -s ip port in the same folder and a small PHP development server is launched. Now let's take our browser and go to 127.0.0.1.8.8.8.8. And we have here our test page. If we open the developer tools and refresh the page, we can also see the result of the function call to x, the two console.logs. Cool. Now let's simulate the XSS. Justin Gardner said that the injection happened inside the second parameter as a string. So let's replace the second string here with a PHP variable output. And this is just how PHP works. Basically, whatever $XSS evaluates to, it will replace this PHP snippet with that value. Now we just have to set this value, and for that let's write some more PHP up here. Again, this is just some basic PHP code, just copy and paste it from somewhere. We set the variable $XSS to empty string, but if we have the get parameter XSS set, we then set XSS to that. And this will work nicely with the HTML form that we created because submitting that form will add a get parameter to the URL. Also, Justin mentioned that there was a XSS filter that didn't allow the use of parentheses, backticks, and single quotes. So let's add a prec replace that replaces these characters with nothing, basically removing them. Now we can go back to the browser and we can use the XSS get parameter or the form to simulate the injection. XSS 123. And we can see in the developer tools, in the HTML code, we are now calling x with 123. And in the console, we can also see the console.logs from the function call to x. Now, before we look again at how Justin got XSS here, let's play a little bit ourselves. So our goal is XSS, cross-site scripting. By the way, I made a short series about where the name comes from. If you are interested in some hacker history, definitely go watch that. Also, if you watch that, then you might also understand that a better name for XSS might be JavaScript injection. So our goal is to somehow inject and execute arbitrary JavaScript that we want. And in this case, we know that the attacker can control the string of the second parameter. But inside a string, we cannot execute any JavaScript. It's just a string. But what about when we break out of the string? Double quotes should be allowed. Let's see. That works. See how our injection now led to the function x being called with three parameters? While the function doesn't expect a third parameter, this is not an error in JavaScript. So you can see our JavaScript code executes just fine. And this is what Justin meant when he said, my solution made use of the fact that any function in JS can take any number of parameters. Cool. So where do we go from here? How can we execute arbitrary JavaScript code? Typically, in such a case, you could simply close the function call, add your own code like alert document.domain, and place a JS comment at the end just to avoid any JS syntax error. But the problem is parentheses are not allowed. They get replaced. So we can inject quite some stuff, but without parentheses, how can we call arbitrary functions? There are a few tricks with, for example, backticks, alert backtick, one backtick that would work, but backticks are also not allowed. Well, let's go on a short detour. Let's look at another typical XSS case that can happen in client-side redirections. So sometimes code uses window.location to redirect the user to another page. Assigning window.location equals /ASD would, for example, redirect to /ASD. But you can also use full URLs and redirect to https://hex3.io. But besides relative or absolute URLs, you can also use JavaScript URIs. These allow you to execute JavaScript code in the current origin. So window.location equal JavaScript alert 1 will execute alert 1. And now we are almost at the full explanation of this code. Just one small thing. What's important to know is here is that with JavaScript in the browser, the window object is very special. Alert is actually a variable or function registered on the window object. So the full function path would be window.alert1. We just use the shorthand alert1 all the time because the objects in the window object are globally accessible. And fun fact, our x function is the same way. It exists here as windows.x, but we can just call it with x. This also works with HTML IDs. If we have a div with ID test, this HTML element will be accessible from JavaScript via windows.test or just test. So let's come back to our injection. What Justin is actually doing here, he assigns a string to location, or rather window.location. It might just look confusing without the window dot, but it's just an assignment. So if in the injection we assign https://hex3.io, we get redirected. And yeah, it obviously works, but it might look a little bit weird just seeing it like this. This is an assignment, and this is also a parameter to this function. This looks like bad code, but this is just how lots of programming languages work. In the case of JavaScript and many other languages, a variable assignment, when it gets evaluated, actually returns a value. If you assign a equal 1 in the console, you see here the return value 1. If you place it in parentheses, it is maybe a bit clearer. Or here as a parameter to console log, a equal 1 returns 1, so console log prints 1. So yeah, this variable equal string inside a parameter looks like invalid JavaScript, but it's totally legal. And now we can put everything together. We inject location equal JavaScript alert 1 and doesn't work. Well, of course it doesn't work because parentheses are not allowed. But because we assign here a string, we can simply use hex encoding to encode the parentheses. So hex to 8 and hex to 9 should work. Let's try it again. And here we go. We get the alert box. Cool. Now we understand this tweet and we can move deeper. Let's move on to the quoted tweet by Mathias Carlson. Here we see another variant of somewhat the same thing, but there are quite a few differences that are worth exploring. So first of all, the cool thing here is that it doesn't need any commas. So in case you cannot add another parameter via the injection, this would still work. The trick here is to use arithmetics instead, or rather string concatenation, string plus string. And in order to concatenate one string to another, this part of the addition needs to be evaluated. But if we go back to the XSS from Justin and try plus with the assignment, that wouldn't work because now there is a syntax error. JavaScript doesn't know in what order to execute this. First the assignment or first the subtraction. So you get an invalid left-hand side exception. If you could inject parentheses, then that wouldn't be a problem. This way you can force JavaScript to first evaluate the assignment and then the result is used for the string concatenation or string subtraction. But because you cannot inject parentheses, Mathias' solution is pretty neat. He defines here a JavaScript object, and this object contains a key A, and the value of A is set to, of course, the result of the assignment to window.location. So basically, by using a JavaScript object, you can make sure the JavaScript syntax is valid to be able to perform the location assignment. Pretty neat. But there's one more. The second example is another variation of this idea. Here a new class B is created, and this class overrides the toString method with an arrow function. So when we execute it, it will execute this part, which is again the assignment to window.location. And toString is executed when you attempt to use plus for a string concatenation. JavaScript wants to append a string, and to figure out how this object or class is represented as a string, it calls toString, triggering the assignment. Anyway, this is just very condensed JavaScript, and it can look very scary. Both of them are pretty neat, but there's one trick hidden in here which you might have noticed, and that is the name. Unlike Justin's example directly assigning a string, Mathias assigns the variable name to it. And maybe you have guessed it already. What is this mysterious variable name? Of course, it's another global variable that exists on window, window.name. Right now it's an empty string, but this one is ultra weird if you haven't seen it before, because you can actually set this from another website. When you dynamically open a new window in JavaScript with window.open, you can actually define a window name. So let's call this window test. We execute it, the new window opens, and if we now, on the open page, look at the window name, we can see it's test. This allows us to optimize the XSS from before. We don't even need to care about the string encoding and the parentheses. We just place all our JavaScript payload into the name. And in our XSS get parameter, we now assign name to the location. So if we execute this window open, we now trigger the XSS. Pretty neat. You see, the name variable trick is incredibly useful for XSS in situations where you don't have a lot of space for your payload or there's some annoying character filtering happening. So if you didn't know this trick, well, now you know. And it was hiding here in plain sight in Mathias's tweet. Cool, that's kinda it. Now I hope you understand these two tweets and what you can learn from them. But I have one small addition to this as well. Justin didn't say whether pointy brackets were not allowed and how exactly the context looked like. But in our case here, we could also inject a closing script tag. And now we can inject, for example, SVG onload to trigger XSS. Of course, we can still not use the parentheses directly, but we can make use of the name trick again to get our payload in there. So that might have been another solution as well. Please let me know in the comments what you think about this format. Was this fun? Is this useful? Also, if you come across any tweets or toots or posts that you don't understand, send them to me on Twitter or Instagram. My DMs are open, and maybe I can explain your tweet next. And if you're interested in more hacking tutorials, check out my channel. It's full of free content. But we are also currently building hextree.io. This is an online training platform built by me and Stack Smashing, and it's currently in the closed beta. But I hope soon we are opening it up further. We still need to produce a lot of content for it, but eventually we will get there. So check out hextree.io, go follow us on Twitter, and join our Discord. And if you want to support my free videos on YouTube, check out my Patreon, the YouTube membership, or shop.liveoverflow.com. By purchasing my shitty handwriting font, you can support this channel and you get something useful in return. Maybe if you had read that tweet in my font, it would have been easier to understand, right? Anyway, see you soon.